coming. This is the second in a series of lasting legacies that the Harlem Cultural Archives has hosted. 2 years ago, we recognized the contributions of Percy Sutton and Basil Patterson with a panel of Charlie Rangel, David Dinkins, who hopefully will be here a little later on, and the late Roscoe Brown, who actually connected me with City College. I'm just happy to be able to recognize the accomplishments of the Clarks and Northside Center. I'm very fortunate to have a dear friend of mine, Thelma, who's done amazing work there to carry on their legacy. And I'd like to introduce her. This is Dr. Thelma Dye.
Thank you. And let me thank Glenn Hunter of Harlem Cultural Archives for working with Northside and even suggesting that this conference happen. So thank you. He's worked tirelessly to bring this about. So thank you, Glenn. So hello, everyone, and thank you for coming. I know what it's like kind of coming out on a Saturday, but we appreciate it. It's a beautiful day, and we guarantee you that this will be a very interesting discussion. We have some great panelists, great keynoter, and a wonderful moderator, and lots going on in our world now. So welcome again, and on behalf of Northside Center for Child Development and Harlem Cultural Archives, thank you for coming to the Lasting Legacies Conference of Drs. Kenneth and Mamie Clark. I'm delighted to welcome you here this afternoon and to talk about the legacy of the Clarks and their work with youth and what's past, present, current, and what's ahead of us in the future. When Harlem Cultural Archives and Northside began to plan for this conference, it was a while back, and we both acknowledged our strong interest in preserving and reminding people of our history, our successes, and where we as institutions of Harlem still needed to focus. For Harlem Cultural Archives, it was clear. They wanted to tell our story. They wanted to tell the story of our struggles, our successes, of our elders, and preserve Harlem's memories and history for generations to come, and they've done a great job and continue to do a good job with that. For Northside, Northside Center, which currently provides mental health, educational enrichment programs, Head Start, and family support service to over 4,000 children each year, it's our 70th anniversary. We serve children and families who come to us in need, in poverty, and in need of emotional support. We were founded in 1946 at a time when segregation was the legal law of the land. Two black psychologists, Mamie and Kenneth Clark, rose to prominence on their work, on their study, the Black-White Doll Study. That is the study that black children were shown black and white dolls. And it is that study that seemed to so clearly demonstrate the rejection of children of their blackness. And as well, not only black children rejected the black dolls, but it also implied that all children, and as we saw in recent studies, in fact, when you show black children and other children black and white dolls to choose from, overwhelmingly they choose the white doll as a nice doll, a pretty doll. This was a study whose impact was so great that it was used in the 1954 Brown versus the Board of Education Supreme Court decision that legally ended segregation of public schools. So for Northside, when this conference began, it was an opportunity to celebrate Northside's history, to look at all that had been achieved, and to focus on youth and the fact that our youth continue to be left behind, confined, and actually ill-defined. We wanted to do this in the backdrop of the Clarks' work with HARU, which was also known as Harlem Youth Unlimited. It was a group that was formed in the 60s to promote opportunities and change for Harlem's youth, which they ultimately published a manuscript, which some of you have asked about at the table. It's actually one of the original publications, so I really can't share it, but I wanted you to see it. But in your packets, you have a summary, an executive summary of that study. But that was in 1964, and it was a time when, while there was despair, things were happening, so there was hope. So the manuscript was published in 1964, and it was titled Youth in the Ghetto, A Study of the Consequences of Powerlessness and a Blueprint for Change. That was Dr. Clark, Dr. Kenneth Clark was the leader. So that was our goal back then, to have a conference, and we knew that after it would be after the election day, and there would be a lot of upbeat people around. But that was before this election, the 9th of November, 11-9, as we refer to it, and we are now know that when 9-11 roll around in America, we've got to be well prepared for whatever could come our way. So we are still going to focus on youth, and we're still going to focus on the future and how we can help and move them along and support them so that they can be all they want to be, so that they can become strong, unconfined by boundaries, and have a bountiful future. And we want to be solution-oriented today. But we know that that discussion today cannot happen without asking our speakers to make remarks on the obvious and the potential implication for our youth and all of us in America, for the, given what may happen in the next 4 years, which officially begins Inauguration Day 2017. So speakers, we do look forward to hearing your thoughts and your take and all that you think about youth and what we need to do and what we need to focus on. So with this, I want to thank you all again for coming. I look forward to our discussion, and it's my pleasure to tell you a bit about and introduce Professor Wallace Ford, our moderator, who will be in charge of this conference as soon as I finish his introduction. Wallace Ford is an educator and author. He is the professor and chair of the Department of Public Administration at Medgar Evers College in the City University of New York. He has authored two novels, The Pride and What You Sow, published by Kensington Books. He is a graduate of Dartmouth College and Harvard Law School. He has worked as a private attorney for a variety of firms and has used his vast experience and expertise to serve as a management consultant to a number of national and international firms and governmental agencies. Most notably, Professor Ford is the author of Point of View, a commentary blog column read in over 60 countries. It is a contemporary column for the 21st century. It is widely read, and I read it all the time, and I invite you to. In your packets, in your bags, there are there's a biography of our panelists. There are also a link to Professor Ford's column. Thank you, Dr. Ford, for taking on this grand task of moderating this conference, particularly during this current climate. Thank you, Dr. Ford. Wallace.
Thelma so much for the opportunity. When she invited me to be a moderator, and she and I didn't go back far enough that I knew I was not going to say no to whatever she asked me to do. And when she told me about this particular conference, I had to share with her. And Dr. Ross, I think you're familiar with the expression, you may be familiar with the expression that coincidence is God's way of staying anonymous. Okay. And so what Thelma and I did not know is that my history with Dr. Clark is actually a very personal one, in that I met Dr. Kenneth Clark when I was a student at Dartmouth in 1968. And Dr. Clark gave a presentation, his very popular book at the time was Dark Ghetto. And after he made his presentation, I wasn't shy. I was about 18 years old, and I asked him if I could get a summer job. And he said, well, as a matter of fact, and I sent him a resume and what have you. I wound up becoming one of the first student interns at the Metropolitan Applied Research Center. which was a tremendous opportunity for me personally. And the debt that I owe to Dr. Clark for providing me with that opportunity is just absolutely eternal. And so when it came time to say yes, it was not an easy call. It was a no call. Of course I would do this, and I'm so very happy to be able to do so. I'm going to introduce Dr. Ross just now. I did want to make note of one item which Thelma and I had mentioned, which I think is important. The time when I accepted when I said yes, to the request to be here. Of course, we all anticipated a different atmosphere on November 12th, and I just had a note that I shared with some of my students out in Brooklyn at Medgar's College, which was just that, and it comes from I attend St. Charles Borromeo Roman Catholic Church in Harlem, and we have a great choir, and the choir sings a number of songs, and one of the songs begins with, "Be not dismayed, God will take care of you." And what we do know also is that God takes care of those who take care of themselves. And so what we have to do is to translate sorrow into joy. We will translate defeat into victory. And whatever failure we may have experienced, we will translate that into success. I do believe that about each and every one of us here in this room and everyone we know. And we will move forward in that way, in that fashion. And so with that, let me just, as I said, just give a few words with respect to our keynote speaker. And Dr. Phyllis Harrison Ross is aptly described as a community mental health administrator and public servant with over 35 years of experience in program development, hospital and clinical administration, and teaching and research. With these 35 years in the community mental health profession, Dr. Phyllis Harrison Ross presents a remarkably diverse career as a hospital clinical administrator, researcher, academician, public health consultant, forensic and child psychiatrist, and public educator. And when we were speaking before the proceedings began, I mentioned that I first met her at that Metropolitan Applied Research Center, which was first opened in 1968. And she was kind enough to say she might remember me. She didn't remember me, which was okay, because that means I didn't behave that badly, because that means which is probably the only reason she would have remembered me. So I'm thankful for that. From the startup in 1973 to 1999, Dr. Harrison Ross was at the helm of the Metropolitan Hospital Community Mental Health Center as its director and chief of psychiatry, and she was the associate medical director of the Metropolitan Hospital and president of the medical board. Her biography is extensive. Let me just say that she is a distinguished life fellow of the American Psychiatric Association, former president of the Black Psychiatrists of America, and also served as an elected member of the governing council of the American Hospital Association. We are privileged and really blessed to have Dr. Phyllis Harrison Ross, who is also an emeritus professor of psychiatry and behavioral health services at New York Medical College. We're very pleased to have her here as our keynote speaker, and I ask you to join me in welcoming her this afternoon. Thank you.
I want to make certain, can you hear me all right?
Yes.
Good, good. Well, thank you so much, and faculty, students, friends, colleagues, and family, it's a good and a great honor to be with you today and to give this keynote address. The work of Drs. Kenneth and Mamie Clark is completely intertwined with the work that has animated my life and career. And so this is a special moment for me, both personally and professionally. I knew I wanted to be a doctor at age 4. There was a radio show called Joyce Jordan, MD, and it used to play on all the major radio stations, ABC, CBS, NBC. And it followed the day-to-day life of the title character, a surgeon at a big city hospital who had to balance the demands of her job with those of her family. I wanted to be her. And my parents supported my ambition. As a matter of fact, when I said it, I'm dancing around through the house, and my father said, "Oh, yes, right, that's fine." And he was completely thrilled by the idea. At that time, you know, it was important in the Black community to be a doctor. So he had no objections to that. He was a public school administrator and an educator. And after years of studying and jumping through hoops of medical education, I graduated from Wayne State University College of Medicine in 1959. Now, unlike Dr. Jordan, I ultimately chose psychiatry as my specialty. I should add that my mother was a social worker, and she was one of these analytic kind initially. And so I really come from a social work education background. Although I began my career as a pediatrician, I ultimately switched to psychiatry because I saw firsthand how the silent scourge of mental illness disrupted lives and destabilized families. And I decided that my life's work would be to alleviate those kinds of struggles. Mental health is a problem that we can't ignore, and if we do, it's at our own peril. It's everybody's problem. I first met Dr. Clark and Dr. Clark in 1967 at a social event of the 100 Black Men, of which Kenneth Clark was a member. This was shortly after I had completed my child and adolescent psychiatry residency training, and I was thrilled to be at this party. 100 Black Men is a special organization that does fantastic work. Founded in 1963, its goal is to leverage the collective expertise of business, political, and community leaders in servicing and addressing systemic inequity and empowering African American as agents of change in their respective communities. Dr. Kenneth Clark became a mentor to me. He encouraged me to focus on issues related to children in the African American community. At the time, he was working on Harlem Youth Opportunities Unlimited, more commonly known as HARU, which was a social activism organization that he founded and you've heard about. Its work dovetailed with that of the 100 Black Men in the sense that both sought to increase the educational and professional opportunities that young Black men could access. I have to say, of course, I also went to 100 Black Men functions because I was looking for a Black man. Now, HARU came about thanks in large part to the Johnson administration, which provided more than $100 million at that time, that's a lot of money, to support the extension of preschool programs and after-school programs for children and employment programs for dropouts. Kenneth's work and personal encouragement convinced me that public service was worth it. But he wasn't always a warm and fuzzy figure. He could be gruff, and he never suffered fools. He and I worked with the criminal justice colleagues, this was at Mark, I don't know if you remember this, on a treatise entitled A Study of Corporal Punishment in the Public Schools. And at that time, I was working for the Child Guidance Bureau at the New York City Board of Education. He told me that learning about politics would make me a more effective mental health advocate. So he recommended me to then Governor Nelson Rockefeller to become a member of the New York State Commission on Quality, Cost, and Financing of Primary and Secondary Education. And that was very important because I learned at that point the interrelationship of all of that and how to look for outcomes and to demand that there be positive outcomes. And with that, my political public service career was off and running. Now that being said, underneath it all, I knew that Dr. Clark saw something in me. That's very important. He saw something in me, and he said that to me. I was proud of that, and so I did all I could to make good on the faith that he had placed in me. I have been fortunate enough to receive some great honors in my life, ranging from my time at Metropolitan Hospital as Chief of Psychiatry to my appointment by the same Governor Rockefeller in 1976 to the Medical Review Board of the New York State Commission of Correction, a role that informs my work to this day, and I'm still working at it, and I'm 80. The New York State Commission of Correction, and I am the commissioner, has a mission to provide for a safe, stable, and humane correctional system in New York State. And that means for every jail, lockup, NYPD, Rikers, Attica, in the state. Our responsibility is to promulgate minimum standards for the management of the correctional facilities, including secure juvenile facilities, which, by the way, the state is trying to close down. We evaluate, investigate, and oversee all local state correctional facilities and police lockups. And specifically, I investigate every death that occurs in any of those facilities. Every death that occurs in any of those facilities is reported to me within 24 hours. The commission assists in developing new correctional facilities and provides technical assistance. This has been, what you might say, my personal nursery school to prison pathway from the hospitals. And in 1999, I was appointed as a commissioner at the State Commission of Correction. Service to our community has been a bedrock of my professional life, and advocating for us alongside the likes of former Mayor Dinkins, Congressman Charlie Rangel, and Adam Clayton Powell Jr. I go back that far, and it's always been a great sense of pride to me. For the entirety of the American Black cultural memory, and I'm sure that Mr. Hunter is very much aware of this, Black parents have had to explain to their children what it means to be Black. For generations, mothers and fathers have had to tell their sons and daughters that they will be treated differently because of the color of their skin. More recently, these conversations have included warnings about the police, training them to deal with the police, and for good reason. Thanks to the spread of social media and the viral videos of Black children being hunted down despite their obedience, civility, and innocence, what do we tell our kids now? This is a question that I hope we talk a little bit about today. How are these kids supposed to react and behave when they are confronted by the police? How do we raise children knowing that no matter what they do or how they look, they may be harmed by government agencies that we pay for in a country that we built? And to what extent Does this question merit psychological, psychiatric, or psychoanalytic consideration? How are mental health professionals to deal with the oppression of black and brown children by some of the police in the face of their continued innocence? How do we teach bureaucrats and justice officials to recognize the precursors to genocide, like mass incarceration? President Obama established a commission on the prevention of genocide. Will it remain under the incoming administration? Additionally, we passed through the Senate the perpetuation of the commission. It hadn't passed the House yet, so I'm very concerned about that. But one of the organizations on whose international board I sit, I sit on the international board, and it's the Auschwitz Institute for Peace and Reconciliation, received a grant to work with the Martin Luther King Center and the FBI to begin to train police and FBI agents in identifying early signs of genocide. And that training is supposed to begin in April of next year. Dr. Clark died a little over a decade ago, but I've always tried to take his spirit with me. I've always seen myself as a gadfly to those in power, as someone who always keeps the interest of the underserved at heart. That's why all of our youth at the New York State Office of Children and Family Services, OCFS, and the Division of Juvenile Justice and Opportunities for Youth are afforded mental health treatment services, individual meetings, groups, and medications when applicable, so that our participation rate is as high as possible. By the way, at Rikers, 47% of the inmates are described as having, are found to have mental illness. Clearly, all youth do not engage or benefit from such services, but as they return to the community, to our community, they all will need and use clinical services, mental health services, and educational remediation in order to become productive citizens and members of society. Services as those provided by the Northside Center for Child Development. Our work is clearly cut out for us, and here are just a very few sobering statistics, because I know we're all kind of like distrusting numbers these days. At the end of 2015, there were 726 youth in residential care, in voluntary and OCFS agencies, 25 in OCFS non-secure agencies, 117 in OCFS limited secure facilities, and 165 in OCFS secure facilities. And secure, of course, means that because of their dangerousness. 87% of those have substance abuse problems, 76% have mental health problems, 55% have special education needs, 7.6% are registered sex offenders, 45% have limited English proficiency. This week's election is certainly motivating us to recognize that there will be a need for ethical, common sense solutions that prioritize early identification and early treatment of children in need. I am proud to be a member of the Northside Center family, which has made, to its credit, an early start, a very early start, in coming together as a community of all types of people to do this important work. They have the experience and they have the know-how. They just, unfortunately, we're also as struggling for funding, although we're doing very well. Thelma is a fabulous person and a fabulous representative of it, but there's so much pressure that people like myself, government officials, and I'll take credit for it, who monitor and regulate and see, can't you do it cheaper, and all of these things that she has to deal with, and I am amazed at how she manages to juggle her way through all of that and maintain such a successful institution. I'm also very excited about the support of televisiting services at the New York Society for Ethical Culture, where children of incarcerated parents can maintain contact with that parent by television. And parents of incarcerated youth can maintain visual contact with their children who are incarcerated. We must continue to have conferences like this one that we're having today to find common ground, common justice, and support each other in our work. And I know that you will be motivated today by our wonderful panel, as I was when I met the Drs. Clark almost 50 years ago. I took the baton from them, but now it's time for me to pass it on to a new generation of health professionals and advocates who are rooted in our community. I urge you to grasp it tightly, run as far as you can, and pass it on to the next generation, just as I am now doing. This will demand commitment and sacrifice, but it's impossible to overstate the satisfaction of a life lived in service to others. There are other paths that I could have chosen, but the one I chose has left me with no regrets. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Before I forget, a couple of things. We gave you those little pads in case you have questions to ask the panelists. Please jot them down if you want to make it to a particular panelist or in general. We welcome that. In addition to that, I'd like to welcome the 106th mayor of New York City, Mayor Jenkins. And as well, I would like to piggyback on what Dr. Ross said about Dr. Clark seeing something special in an individual. And I'd like to present another person we found as special, just like you. And I'd like to stand up for a second. His name is Elaine Shulman. He worked directly for Dr. Clark. I say for Elaine, the difficult takes a while, the impossible just takes a little bit longer. Thank you.
Thank you again, Dr. Ross, for your inspiring words. Much appreciated and much needed today, for sure. I was doing just fine until I introduced David Dinkins. I used to work for David Dinkins, actually, on more than one occasion. And so I'm not used to having a case of nerves, but when your old boss shows up now, I know I have to be on my A game. So I'll try and do the best I can, Mr. Mayor. Okay. It is now time to introduce our panelists to begin our panel discussion. So I'm going to introduce them individually, and it'll come up, and then we'll get going. So with that, our first panelist is Attorney Valentina Morales. She is a chief Regional Supervisor at the Mental Hygiene and Legal Services in the First Judicial Department. She leads two teams of attorneys in providing legal representation to persons committed to psychiatric hospitals throughout New York County, as well as those receiving court-ordered inpatient care. While at MHLS, Attorney Morales has led research initiatives aimed at addressing quality of care issues and consistently advocates to improve individual hospital policies and practice. Attorney Morales is a graduate of Wellesley College and Columbia University's Law School, and I'd ask you to please join me in welcoming Attorney Valentina Morales. Our next panelist is Dr. Kirkland C. Bonds. He is a licensed psychologist and psychoanalyst. He has been in private practice in New York since 1991. And focusing on boys and teenagers. Dr. Vaughns is the founding editor of Journal of Infant, Child, and Adolescent Psychotherapy and is assistant clinical professor at Adelphi University's Deamer Institute. He has appeared on television and radio and presents at many major conferences on a regular basis. He is a graduate of the University of Illinois and has received his doctorate from New York University, and he is the author of Psychology of Black Boys and Adolescents. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Kirkland Bonds. We have, as our final panelists, Judge Milton A. Tingling. He's a state Supreme Court justice with deep connections to the courts, and he has been appointed New York County Clerk, filling a position that was held for 45 years by Mr. Norman Goodman. Judge Tingling was a justice for the New York County Supreme Court civil term in the First Judicial District of New York, and he was elected to this position in 2001. His career on the bench began in 1996 when he was appointed to the New York City Civil Court. He has served on the Civil Court until 2000, and as you said, was elected to the New York County Supreme Court in 2001. He is a graduate of Brown University. As a Dartmouth graduate, we won't hold that against him. And also has received his law degree from North Carolina Central School of Law. Please join me in welcoming Judge Milton. As you can see, there is no chair for me, but that's okay. I'm going to go get a chair. Part of that self-help doctrine we've been talking about. Please take a seat. But in the meantime, panelists, we've discussed this already, so we're going to get moving here. I was asked to try to provide some type of panel mission with the outstanding individuals we have on this panel. They need no further prompting, I am sure, except to say, please begin. So our panel mission, basically we're here to celebrate, to discuss, and to understand the legacy of Drs. Kenneth and Mamie Clark. We ask you, panelists, to please consider that legacy from the perspective of the past, and what we know of that past, the present, and what we know about the present today, and as you perceive the future. And per your perspective on these areas, we'd ask that you comment from any and all perspectives. And we will begin with Attorney Morales. And if you would begin, and then we'll go in order as introduced. And then we'll begin with the questions and answers, which is always a good part of the event as well. So we ask you to please consider questions. And as I tell my students at Medgar's College, if you don't interact, the process is always going to be incomplete. So we look forward to you doing that. But with that, please let me introduce again Attorney Morales, and we will begin. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much for inviting me to come and speak. It's very much an honor for me to be up here with these very accomplished individuals and leaders in the community. I thought today, you know, as I was thinking about the legacy of Dr. Clark, and obviously I did not know Dr. Clark, I thought a lot about the primary issue that often arises in my representation of my clients currently and my clients in the past. I began my legal career as a public defender at the Neighborhood Defender Service of Harlem. And I continued, even when I moved from the public sector into the private sector, to advocate on behalf of prisoners, primarily women who were being excluded from the nursery program at Rikers Island. And one consistent element that I have most often found in the experiences of my clients is trauma. And I've heard that term thrown around. It appears in the literature. But I'm not sure that treatment modalities, in actuality, have quite caught up with the effects of trauma, with what living in and with trauma is like. And as psychiatric treatment and mental health treatment, in my current experience, largely from the perspective of inpatient care, as well as the outpatient treatment that many of my clients receive once they're discharged from the hospital, is that that treatment has become largely driven by pharmacology. And access to psychotherapy, access to the real core, I think, in what I've read and what I've seen, the mission of Dr. Clark, emotional support, finding the emotional support to even endure treatment for mental illness is really absent. It's absent from the conversations about how treatment is provided, how resources are allocated, and it specifically affects communities of color. And I don't have to explain why. If you look at the overt violence of speech that hasn't really gone away, coupled with incessant microaggressions that people in communities of color endure on a daily basis, and how those tiny little pieces just keep accumulating into what can often seem like an insurmountable obstacle, there is a real need for a discussion both within the community and outside the community of how young people navigate trauma, because quite frankly, it can't be prevented. But there's a certain emotional language that we can teach our children that will help them not only advocate for themselves, but help the individuals that advocate on their behalf, help them in creating a space where they can be heard. I never think of my advocacy for my clients as empowering them or giving them a voice, but more making space for them so that their voice, which they have, which is theirs, can be heard. And so I'm hoping that going forward, as we look into the future, we can kind of dissect the issue of trauma and talk about it within the community in a culturally competent way. And I think that's another point that I wanted to discuss today. You know, I oversee two teams of trial attorneys. We are housed at Bellevue Hospital Center and Metropolitan Hospital Center, respectively. And we cover a number of the private hospitals that have locked psychiatric units as well. And not many people who have mental health concerns or mental illness are necessarily voluntarily or involuntarily committed to a psychiatric hospital, right? This is kind of the more severe end of the spectrum. But I have to say, just like accessing healthcare, there are many communities of color that access their mental health care through the hospital. And usually when it's come to the point where it prevents them from functioning, right? So there's very little in terms of resources along the way or in terms of conversation about accessing those existing resources in a culturally competent way. And On these units across the city, I have yet to come across one Black or Latino attending psychiatrist on any of the units. And I say that because I think it makes a difference. There are some psychiatrists who are formally trained. I can think of one. There's one Black psychiatrist at Harlem Hospital who is trained in Haiti. But other than that, I have yet to come across an attending psychiatrist, including on the forensic units at Bellevue Hospital, where the overwhelming majority of the patients are African American. I think it makes a difference. I think it makes a difference about how we discuss mental health care, how we talk about different interventions. I just published a report with my agency in conjunction with Disability Rights New York 2 weeks ago about the use of mechanical restraints at Bellevue Hospital, wrist and ankle restraints on psychiatric patients, including on the forensic units, which as compared to other public hospitals are alarmingly high. And so again, as we talk about trauma and we talk about treatment and we talk about the legacy of providing emotional vocabulary and emotional support, I think it's imperative that we begin that conversation within our different communities and look to training professionals and look to pulling people within the community to start talking with their children about trauma, about finding the words to articulate how they are feeling, about not feeling guilty about accessing therapists or mental health care, which is kind of a recurring theme. Many of my clients, even our younger clients, when we go to court with them, it's just us. And I know there are a number of reasons for that, but I think that coming together as a community to discuss mental health, to discuss trauma, to discuss creating a framework and a way of addressing issues the way we would medical health issues is imperative.
Thank you very much. Dr. Bonds?
Thank you. First of all, I want to say that I thank you for inviting me for this invitation. It's a real honor. And by my introduction, I sound as if I'm the scholarly type. So let me tell you who I am.
Okay.
I do write, I do publish, and all that good stuff. But I was also the regional director of the New Hope Guild, a mental health facility, the largest outpatient mental health facility in Brooklyn for 25 years. So in order to prepare for this conference today, I thought I would read up on Kenneth and Mamie Clark. So I reread two of his books, Ghetto?
Dark Ghetto
and Prejudice and Your Child. And the third book I read was by two other authors about the history of Northside. And I had two reactions to it. The first was a sense of pride that when I directed clinics in Brooklyn, I was in the same line as what he was doing. The other reaction I had was to feel completely exhausted by all the work that they accomplished. It was just reading it, I felt exhausted. Now, you asked, the question is, so what? What about today? I think this, first of all, it's depressing, but we have to acknowledge mental health as an official system has all but abandoned youth of color. And in its stead, we have the juvenile injustice system in its place. So I think that we need to really focus on that. And that begins, I used to think it began around the fourth grade. I am a professor at Adelphi University, which is in Garden City, which to buy a house there, you've got to start at about $2-3 million. But we have a doctoral program in psychology. And we have developed a mental health clinic in Hempstead, which is Black and brown and poor. Our initial focus are on kids who are in pre-K, kindergarten, first, second, and third grade. And the reason we chose to focus there is because they had a high expulsion rate and a high suspension rate. So this is occurring in pre-K. That for me is the initiation, is the building block of the pipeline. So we want to stop that. Now, Attorney Morales mentioned the pharmacological perspective on treatment. Our kids are being drugged out. The main drug that our children are taking are prescription drugs, not drugs that they're actually buying on the street. Everybody's being diagnosed as ADHD. Whether they're ADHD or not, I have issues with that. But what we're really talking about is an inability to self-regulate. That's all ADHD is, and through therapy. Now, in reading Dr. Clark, he did not accept psychoanalysis at all. And back in his day, I daggone well don't blame him, because where it was just a part of looking downward at black folks. It has changed today. I would invite everyone to look for a film called Black Psychoanalysts Speak. It's a panel of black analysts, and we speak to the issues today. I think in the schools it's not just enough to provide treatment for these children, but to move in the schools and work with them to have them change into a transformative sense of justice. They have taken on a very position of penalty, wanting to punish kids. Either you're doing what you're told to do, and it's very hard for many kids, especially when they're coming from broken homes, when they're coming from homes where there's only one person providing food, that person tends to be overwhelmed. Another comment that got made was microaggression. I want to introduce somebody to you. His name is Dr. Warren Spielberg. He's right there in the green shirt, the white dude. He's my co-editor of the books, The Psychology of Black Boys and Adolescents. Okay. And in our study, we spent 10 years because we wrote a book, and then it got thrown away by the publisher. They said nobody wants to read about black boys. So then we said, well, we'll edit some books. And so we went back out, got all kind of folks to contribute. But in there, we would talk with these boys. We would talk with them individually. We would talk with them collectively. And you could hear the trauma. One of the problems is that they're not knowing that they are traumatized. And within the black community and within the Hispanic community, I don't claim expertise on it, but I've treated enough Hispanics to have a firm sense of this. It's not so much guilt, I think, that they're responding to about being seen in therapy. It's shame. And so we have to look at our culture and how it colludes with a system that devalues us, that takes away our humanity. And by simply talking with each other, we can reaffirm our own humanity. We don't need other people to do that. And the longer we wait, the more damaging it's going to be. When we talk about constant microaggressions, we in psychology call that cumulative trauma. It's been there for a long, long time. And Dr. Clark was writing about that in his book, Prejudice and Your Child. Okay. So what he said then holds very true for today. I don't see major changes. There's a club, an upper middle class or upper class black club called Jack and Jill. And Dr. Spielberg and I interviewed a den mother who reported to us that she had set up a special exercise in which they were invited to her home. They had a wonderful lunch, but one half of the group had to serve the other half their lunch before they could eat their own lunch, and they couldn't eat their own lunch until the first half was done, and then they had to serve themselves. And after this exercise was done, she asked, well, what does this remind you of? And they all came back with two things. They said anti-Semitism and sexism. Nobody but nobody owned racism. So trauma confuses, it undermines a sense of social reality, and without the adults, without the parents and co-parents as well. And I don't mean your biological child, I mean taking responsibility for a child of color who's there. Without us informing them and telling them and listening to them and creating the space that the attorney acknowledge it doesn't happen. So from where I sit, we have a tremendous amount of work to do, although my senses and myself included are all within somewhat of a depressive position right now. We have to overcome.
Thank you very much. Dr. Watts, just stay with us.
All right, good afternoon, everybody. All right, so well, I wasn't going to do this, but my mayor is here. And Elaine Shulman is here, so I'm going to make a couple of corrections for the record. Number one was I was not appointed to civil court in 1996. I was elected to civil court. And I say that, appointments are okay, but I say that because my mayor has been such an integral part of my political and judicial career. So that was 1996. And as he was the first African-American mayor of New York City, when I was elected to civil court, I was the first African-American ever elected to the 7th Municipal District seat in the history of New York City. And thanks to the efforts of Mayor Dinkins, who's, like I said, he's been at the center of so much of my political career. Lane Shulman stood by me for so many years. In 2014, I was reelected to New York State Supreme Court. That was on November 4th. And 5 weeks later, I retired. And when I was elected, it was good. I never had to run again. Some people will tell you, well, you don't have to run again. You don't have to talk to anybody again. You can be who you really are if you're not somebody to begin with. And the reason that I retired, having worked for that and having been assisted in getting to that goal, was the opportunity to become the New York County Clerk and Commissioner of Jurors. That's right, every one of you in New York County will get a summons with my name on it. And to become the Clerk of Supreme Court, both Civil and Criminal Division, was an opportunity that had never existed before. And I took the position because in doing so, I became the first African-American County Clerk, Commissioner of Jurors, and Clerk of Supreme Court in the history of New York State. I'm doing this to bring this back around because nobody gets anywhere without the help of others. Now, when it comes to Dr. Clark, I was fortunate enough to meet this man in 1983, and I met him through politics. In my career, I have been the clerk for three Harlem elected judges. The first one was Milton Richardson. And Milton Richardson's district leader was a gentleman named Hilton B. Clark, who happened to be the son of Kenneth Lee Clark. And after I was hired and through that connection, we spent, I'm going to say, I can remember at least six nights with Dr. Clark and Hilton and Judge Richardson. And in echoing what Commissioner Ross Taylor has said, Dr. Clark did not suffer fools kindly. I learned that because when I first met him, I walked up and told him that he was a hero and all the stuff and this and the other and whatnot. And he said, "That's very nice, young man. That and a token will get me on the subway." And so I made it a point every time that I saw him after that, knowing he didn't suffer fools gladly, to shut up. But he talked, and I knew that I was in the presence of someone who had made a difference and continued to make a difference. The definition of legacy is the leaving of money or property to somebody. That's the legal definition. That's the Merriam-Webster definition. But the legacy of Drs. Clark is that, because they did leave us property. On a very personal level, I'm going to speak for myself, but I think in many ways it may be representative of the African-American community. So we all know about the baby doll experiment. And those of us that have been in the law or outside of the law know about Brown v. Board of Education. But on a personal level, growing up in an African-American family, I think people can honestly say we were not educated about mental health issues. See, we didn't have mental health issues. White people had psychiatric issues. They had psychological issues. Our mental health issues were usually resolved very immediately. The back of a hand, a switch that you were made to go pick out. That's right. And maybe sometimes it wasn't big enough or thick enough, so you had to go get another one. But mental health issues were not something that were readily acknowledged within the African-American community. But Dr. Clark took that out of the shadows. They made not only the nation at large, but they made African-American communities recognize that there are mental health issues, that it's not always about how you're raising your kid, that there are factors in this world, whether they are physiological or community or national or cultural, that there are factors in this world that control your mental health destiny. The baby doll experiments, to me, on a personal level, were an education that everything is not resolvable and that these things do exist in every single community. When I was elected to civil court in 1996, I didn't sit in civil court. I sat in criminal court. And you have litigants, defendants that come into criminal court who act crazy. But in criminal court, in the criminal world, people that act crazy are viewed as being normal. They're not viewed as having mental health issues. They're just viewed as acting crazy to get out of punishment. They're so-called acting out. There is a decision that criminal judges can make, which is to refer clients for a mental health examination. But that examination is only to determine whether or not you're competent to stand trial or to go forward in proceeding. It is not to determine whether or not you're crazy. They are two separate and distinct things. And during my time there, quite unfortunately, I saw too many people that were determined to be competent to stand trial. Even though, listen, we live here. You walk down the streets, you know when somebody's crazy. And yet, they were tried, they were convicted, they took pleas. And in taking a plea, you are made to recite that you're doing so of your own free will, that you do not have any impediment or barrier to your taking this plea, and that you are guilty. That's one side of it. And there have been improvements, there have been advances, but that still remains, the difference between being competent to stand trial and simply being crazy or having mental health issues. Because in today's environment, if you put forth that you have a mental health issue, the entire system almost works against you to prove that, yeah, you may have some, but they are not so much that you can't be held liable or guilty. Later on in my career, I had the opportunity to preside over mental hygiene hearings. And that's where I met Valentina. And that's why I retired. No, but what she said, what she opened up with about that the direction today of dealing with mental health issues is pharmacological. It's incredible. You have to imagine being in a hearing out at Ward's Island, Manhattan psych, or at Kirby, the criminal psych portion of Manhattan psychiatric. You have to imagine being in a room with someone who comes up who's obviously been medicated prior to a hearing. Okay? We have Judge Bannon here. She does. You know how it works. So let me tell you how it works. You're walking down the street. Oh, no, I'm sorry. Let me tell you this one, because this is probably the best story at showing how it works. One of my proudest moments at Manhattan Psychiatric Institute was I personally set Jesus free. Yeah, you heard me. I set Jesus free. He's a young man, white guy, 27 years old. He had the long hair. He had a beard, dressed all in white. He was sitting at 43rd Street on a blanket. And as the tourists went by, God bless you. Have a nice day. Jesus is here. And so somebody walked up to a police officer and said, you know, there's a guy over there sitting on a blanket telling everybody, God bless you. He wasn't in the way. He wasn't obstructed. No one accused him of being violent, of being aggressively active. God bless you. Have a nice day. The officers asked him. They said, sir, do you have some ID? He said, no. They said, can you tell us your name? He said, I'm Jesus Christ. He was then transported to Bellevue, and he was examined by psychiatrists who asked him, what was his name? And he said, I'm Jesus Christ. And what do you think the psychiatrist said? He crazy. And he ended up out at Manhattan Psychiatric Unit on Ward's Island. So he was there for about 6 weeks. And the way the law is, mental hygiene law, all you have to do is indicate to staff or write down that you want to be released. It is a civil confinement. You have not been convicted. So he was there for about 6 weeks, and he wrote a note and he said, it's time for me to go back about my father's business. And so, luckily enough, I got to hear him. And he sat there. Now, the time that he was there, he took every drug that they wanted to try on him. Experimental, regulated, he took every single one. Every report on him was, he didn't fight, he didn't argue, he was most cooperative, he was the perfect client. But now he was ready to go. And so what happens is you have psychiatrists, staff psychiatrists, who testify on behalf of the hospital, and of course they came to testify, this man can't go home, he's crazy. He thinks he's Jesus Christ. So I asked, well, what has he done? Has he cooperated? Has he done anything? Is he able to take care of himself? He testified. He said, I know all the shelters. They know me. He says, I know where to go. He says, when I'm cold, I go to shelters. He says, when I'm hungry, I go to food kitchens. He says, I will volunteer. I serve people. What did the psychiatrist say? Yeah. And so I finally asked him, I said, the law says that when a person is unable to care for their normal daily needs, their activities of daily living, their ADLs, which are basically food, shelter, and clothing. Because remember, there's no violence, there's no crime, there's no aggression. And finally, I said to the psychiatrist, because at this point I'm basically advocating for Jesus. I said to him, I said, well, what is it that you want? Why are you keeping him here? Nothing that you say is that he's going to get better or worse. No medication that you're giving him is supposed to rectify his ailment, which is believing he's Jesus Christ. And finally, the psychiatrist said to me, he said, because somebody out there may be offended that he thinks he's Jesus Christ and attack him. And therefore, he's a danger to himself. Because someone else might attack him. I turned to Valentina because she represents on these things all the time. And so, you know, I looked up and I asked, I said, well, listen, I just have one question for you. I said, who are you? And he said, I'm Jesus Christ. And I said, Jesus, you're going home. And I released him. And he's never been back. But what happens in these things, every day they go on. The medications. You have people attending these hearings that can't advocate for themselves because they're so doped up when they come into the hearings, which of course is being done because they had some issue before. I wanted to tie this into the doctors Clark. The first thing that they gave me and others is education by bringing this issue out of the dark. What they've done presently and for the future is that this exists. One of the things they talked about were the cultural implications on the mental health of youth. And we see it today. You hear Dr. Taylor talk about Rikers Island. One of the things that I've been able to do as the county clerk is to start a project called The Initiative, in which I actively register formerly incarcerated to vote. Most people don't know they can vote. But what's even worse is that most of the formerly incarcerated don't know they can vote. And they don't know because they've been culturally educated and conditioned to once you've done time, you can't vote. Been to Rikers Island registering people who were in Rikers serving sentences. Because with a misdemeanor conviction, you don't lose your right to vote. And if you've had a felony conviction, the only way that you cannot vote again is if you are presently incarcerated or if you are on parole. The Clarks talked about the cultural implications on the minds of our youth. We're going to be talking about the election that took place. I mean, I see people in the audience, I know you walked around and talked and whatnot. Youth don't vote. And I don't think they vote because they've been conditioned not to vote. It's a serious mental health issue. I'm going to stop there because there's a whole lot more to say.
Thank you very much, panel. We're now into the Q&A part of our program. If you have any questions, I think if you could just kind of pass them to the end of the row. And Dr. Harrison Ross, of course, you are more than welcome to participate at any point that you care to do so. While we're waiting for some of the questions to come up from the audience, let me go with a starter question. Any panelists can respond to. But when we talk about the view I'd like to get your view on the impact of the election with respect to this legacy that we're here to discuss today, the legacy of Drs. Kenneth and Mamie Clark. What do you see, and Judge Tingley, you started to allude to it, but I'll ask our other panelists as well to pitch in at this point. What do you hear or see in terms of the youth that we're focused upon, and certainly our honorees are focused upon? What potential impact do you see that this election might have? And we can have at it.
Well, I mean, I can start. I have two children. My son is 9 years old, and my daughter is 7. And, you know, they're fairly young. We discussed the election in my home, of course, and I believe they discussed it in school. And when I told my son that Donald Trump had been elected president, he actually cried. And when he came home, he was a bit frantic, and he said to me, "We have to get cameras. We have to get stuff to protect ourselves. You know, if they come to take you, Mom, I'm not going to let it happen." Now, we have to put this in context, right? My father is an immigrant to this country. I was born in the United States. You know, English and Spanish were both my first language. For my son, despite that, his father is from the Dominican Republic, is not a citizen of the United States. My son goes to school in East Harlem, where a good majority of his classmates are the children of Mexican immigrants and African immigrants. And in my son's mind, the terror that, it's actually possible that someone will come into his home, not, you know, like kind of walking down the street, but into his home and take away his mom. Was very real. It was so real that, you know, he actually started crying, and he's 9. You know, I went to Wellesley College, and there was a huge reception there, obviously, for Hillary Clinton on the night of the election. And, you know, we all communicate, my sisters and I, as we call each other. And the following day, which I'm sure some people have seen in the media, you know, these two gentlemen came from a neighboring college and, you know, drove around in a pickup truck with a flag, you know, Donald Trump, Pence, whatever flag, and then went to the African-American student's house and parked it outside. And when they were asked to leave, there was, you know, I wouldn't call it a discussion, but an exchange, and they attempted to spit at one of the students at the college, right? This is different than anything that I've experienced, you know. I was born in 1978, right? So I don't go back that far, but I don't remember as a child when Ronald Reagan, who I mean, I used to think was like one of the worst historical happenings in the United States, but I don't remember feeling like he was gonna come into my house and take my mom or take my dad. And I don't remember as a child experience, I mean, I grew up in New York City in Hell's Kitchen. I'm born and raised in this city. And we were all, you know, little street kids that did a whole bunch of stuff we shouldn't have done. But I don't ever remember someone saying to us or us saying to each other, you know, you're black, so you're this, or you're Puerto Rican, so you're that, or, you know, or you smell, you should be next to me. And I feel like that has become acceptable, not only political rhetoric, but acceptable conversation in this country in a way that it hasn't been before. And there's this bizarre sense that this is not violent language, you know, this is just free speech, people talking about how they feel as opposed to trying to impart violence, you know. And to see it on such a young level, you know, like my daughter is a little caramel skinned girl, came home to me 2 weeks ago and said, this little girl said something racist to me. She said to her, well, you're a black person. Again, talking about a caramel skinned girl, right? It's like she smelled out the fact that her grandmother is black in her, you know. It said, you know, black people don't get hot. I thought that was hilarious and bizarre, right? Because the little girl said, I'm hot. And my daughter said, I'm cold. And she said, well, you're cold because you're black. Black people don't get hot. They're always cold. And then she said, and they stink. And I just thought, oh my goodness. You know, when I was thinking about emotional language, like how do you equip, I'm thinking very concretely about my godchildren, and I'm thinking about my children, and I'm thinking, how do we equip them with the language to respond to that, with the support network to combat it? The first thing I wanted to do when I heard about the college stuff is I said, we gotta go there. We have to go there. We have to go there in our cars, in our suits. We need to get out like we are all their mothers and demand to have a conversation. And they need to know that we are there for them. They need to know that they are part of a community. And we need as much as possible to counter that violent language with real positive language about ourselves, about our communities, and despite the differences that exist there, kind of bring together a sense of community and alliance. Otherwise, this is terrifying, frankly.
Thank you. Susan?
Yes, before we get started, I asked the Honorable Mayor if he had something to say to add to the conversation.
Oh, should we take a quick poll? Is that okay for everyone? Please welcome once again Mayor David Dinkins.
Thank you all very much. I'm privileged to teach at Columbia University and the graduate students in SIPA, School of International Public Affairs. And so the students are all graduate students, and they come from Africa and Asia and Europe and around this country. And I say to them all the time, whatever you do, do something for somebody else. I don't give a damn if it's the NAACP or the Red Cross. Do something for somebody else. And I figure now and then I may get through to a few of them. But I wanted to come today because Mamie and Ken Clark were dear friends. And in 1965, I first ran for the assembly. And I was in Ray Jones's Carver Democratic Club, Amsterdam, 145th Street, up on the hill, as they call it. And my opponent was Franz Leichter, who came from the famous Riverside Independent Democrats at 106th and Broadway. So to sort of clean me up and make me look better, Dr. Clark became the chairman of my citizens committee. It's my good fortune that he was a friend and client of our law firm, Tom Dyett knew him well, and Ray Jones knew him well. And your humble servant excluded, Ray Jones always backed quality people. Ken Clark got to be a region because of Ray Jones. Constance Baker Motley moved ahead because of Ray Jones. And so I just wanted to come because they were so important to me, dear friends, and it has been said by everyone here, they did an awful lot of good, not just Brown versus the Board of Education, but I can think of so many meetings that we had, and Dr. Clark, Ken Clark, would sit quietly, and then when everybody got through with it, and then he would tell us what really was going on. And he was enormously helpful to so many of us, and people who benefit even today from work that they did do not know that that's why they got ahead. So anyway, I wanted to be here. I apologize for not getting here earlier, but I had an earlier meeting. But I did very much want to be here, and I'm so pleased that this is going on. We need to remember those who have helped us over time.